you ever feel as if you couldn't breathe? Your tongue is thick in your mouth, your throat is hoarse, your lungs are bursting for air. It seems as if the walls of your room are closing in on you, crushing you, crowding you, sealing you off from the rest of the world. And then you awake. It's only been a ghastly dream, a terribly vivid nightmare. But with your eyes open and your hands trembling and your body bathed in perspiration, you relax. At least you're in your own room, safe. And it was only a dream. Or was it? This is a tale that the inmates of Bell Prison still whisper in the cell yards and corridors to this day. The story of John Day, a lifer, and his weird nocturnal dreams. It happened long ago, but cell 13, where it began, still enjoys its haunted history. Listen, and I'll tell you about John Day and his nightmares. One night at 12 midnight, the stone and steel corridors of Row A rang with the hoarse, terrible shouts of a man screaming for the guards. The prisoners, so rudely awakened, would normally have grumbled and yelled their annoyance, but something in the horrible moans and sobbings issuing from cell 13 stilled their tongues. The guards rushed to the cell and swung it open to find John Day crouched in the corner on the floor by his bed, now whimpering and crying, his hands to his throat. At the sight of the guards, he blurted about his nightmare. "The hands," he babbled, "the hands. Thick, calloused, lumpy hands. They were choking me." "Oh, just a nightmare," the guards laughed. But that wasn't the end of it. It was only the beginning of many nights when Row A would be similarly disturbed. John Day and his nightmare about someone strangling him became the talk of Bell Prison. And John Day himself, sentenced to life imprisonment, grew steadily thinner and paler. The warden refused to listen to his pleas for another cell. He wouldn't cater to the whims of convicts. The prison doctor insisted that John Day was only shamming because other than a loss of weight, he was organically and mentally sound. But still the nightmare persisted, and John Day's nocturnal outcries became a familiar sound that the prisoners accepted as another wriggle of their hard existence. But one night came a new sound. The escape sirens wailed over the yard. John Day had escaped, attacked a guard, and gone over the wall. The entire organization of Bell Prison went into action. Guards with bloodhounds scoured the surrounding countryside, and only 2 miles away, one guard with his dog came on a strange sight. A teamster with his heavy wagon pulled over to one side of the road, and lying on the ground, still in his prison uniform, his eyes bulging unnaturally in his head, lay John Day. He was dead. The guard approached the big teamster, a burly giant, and questioned him. The story was simple enough. John Day had halted him with a gun to make use of the wagon, and the teamster had fought back. Luckily, John Day's gun had misfired, and the man had been able to get his hands around his throat. The guard shone his flashlight on the teamster's hands. They were thick, calloused, and lumpy. Big, thorny fingers that had strangled the life out of John Day. Only a nightmare, Bell Prison had thought. Just a convict's curious dream. But when John Day's dead body was returned to the prison morgue, the story of cell 13 became the terrible tale that it is to this day. And what of your dreams and your nightmares? If you ever imagine that fingers are at your throat throttling you, don't twist and turn. Wake up. Open your eyes. Maybe it's just a dream, but someone could be killing you. Thank you. Surely you must have read Hamlet at some time or other in your life. If you did, do you recall that line? There are more things in heaven and hell, Horatio, than ever dreamed of in your philosophy. Well, the strange tale that I'm about to tell you is something like that. My story has to do with traveling and automobiles and a little girl. Do you believe that the dead can influence the living? But come, listen to the incredible history of Martin Cable and the little girl in the polka dot dress. The road was dark and winding that grim night that Martin Cable drove his sedan towards Webb Center. The rain slashed, howled, tore at the windows, and Martin Cable was worried. His headlights had fused out, and driving in unfamiliar territory down an unknown road on such a dreadful night was not the safest thing in the world. But Martin Cable was due in Webb Center on an important business meeting that could mean a whole new life for him. And so he drove on, taking his chances with the weather, with the car, with his life. Suddenly, through the windshield wipers mopping furiously at the glass, Martin Cable saw a flash of something up ahead, a white face in the darkness. Hurriedly, he slammed on the brakes and the car swerved to a halt. Martin Cable peered out onto the road. There was a little girl standing there in a polka dot dress, the rain pelting at her viciously, making of her hair a tangled mess. The child's face was chalk white and ghostly, and before Martin Cable could ask her anything, she came forward and put one tiny hand on the car window and pointed down the road. "Mister," her small voice was pitiful, "you better turn left here. There's a big hole in the ground just ahead. You can't go that way." Gratefully, Martin Cable thanked her and asked her if he could give her a lift home. She shook her head and indicated a grey cottage just to the right of the road. "I'll be all right," she said. "I live just there." So Martin Cable took the turn off and arrived safely at his destination, tired and shaken, but thankful that the little girl had saved his life. The next day, when he inquired about the road, the hotel clerk told him that a rock slide had made an immense pit on the road that would kill anyone who fell into it. Well, Martin Cable completed his business in Webb Center, paid a visit to a toy store, and drove back the way he had come. He decided to repay the little girl for her kindness of the night before. When he drew his car up to the gray cottage, a peaceful serenity hung over the walls and the windows. Martin Cable, with his gift under his arm, knocked loudly on the little oaken door. A small, grey-haired woman came to see who it was, and Martin Cable introduced himself and explained his visit. He wanted to see the little girl, he said. "What little girl?" the woman asked. Martin Cable rushed on to tell about the rain and being lost and saved from certain death. "And describe her to me," the lady said. "What was she wearing?" Confused, Martin Cable mentioned the polka dot dress. But he didn't understand until the lady shook her head sadly. "Yes," she said, "it was Madeline. Once a year she comes to that part of the road and warns some traveller away from the very spot. It's been like that for 5 years now." But Martin Cable was dumbfounded. What did the woman mean? Yet it was all very simple. Madeline was my daughter. And 5 years ago, she died in an accident at the place where she told you to turn. You see, she got run over by a car there. Curious, isn't it? A little girl returning like that to warn the unwary traveller away from death. Oh yes. If you're driving tonight, do be careful. There might be a nasty break in the road.